I built this machine as a sort of combination of milling machine and drill press, but it turns out it's not very good as a milling machine, mostly because it's not stiff enough, especially side to side.
I made the frame of it fairly wide, and I added these cross braces here to keep the posts from going side to side. I figured that would help a lot with stiffness, but it turns out the whole frame can twist because the drill head is actually extending way out to the front here, and when that gets pushed sideways, that actually gives the whole frame kind of a twisting motion like this, and that's something I hadn't really thought of. So I should have possibly made these cross braces here a little bit thicker, which would have helped to resist the twisting motion. So just with my hands, I can move the chuck by half a millimeter in either direction. But in the front to back direction, it's at least twice as stiff. And I made the frame nice and deep so that I could drill a hole in the middle of a big workpiece, which I can't even do with my big drill press. And that of course means everything extends out a bit further. And longer members just aren't as stiff, so this is attached here. And if I put the weight on here, we're down about 0.35 millimeters, but if I apply the force closer to here, then we deflect only half as much. But it gets worse than that. Imagine this member was just a bit shorter. So we move the dial indicator over to here, and then apply the weight, and we just have so much less deflection. So if I wanted to make this a better milling machine, I'd have to forget about having lots of room here. Just make everything very short and stout.
But I really like using this machine as a drill press, and since I built this machine 10 months ago, I haven't really felt the need to mill anything, and watching YouTube channels where people mill stuff, most of that stuff I would have either made out of wood or used an angle grinder.
So optimizing it for drilling was probably the right call. I just wasn't aware how much I'd compromised the milling functionality. And what inspired me to build this, I found this massive BT30 spindle block that weighs 10 kilograms, and it takes these BT30 tool holders like a big milling machine does.
Now, for using it as a drill press, it'd be nice to have a Jacob's chuck that goes right here. So for that, I bought this thing here, which is a Morse taper adapter. So the Morse taper fits in here, drill chuck fits on here, and then that goes in here, but that just sticks way, way, way out. That comes all the way down to here. It'd be much better if this chuck just attached right to the tool holder. So I bought another thing, which is a chuck that has a BT30 spindle already on it, and that fits in here like so. And you can see that is a bit shorter, but this thing is freaking heavy. And it turns out I don't actually like these keyless chucks that much, but that's what I had.
But then I found this drill chuck with a shank on it to go into a hammer drill really cheap on Amazon, and I thought, well, if I just put that shank into a collet, that combination would be actually fairly short. But this is a bit iffy in terms of clamping that in a collet because it's got all those holes in it, and it really didn't run true. It was really wobbly on here. And with nothing to lose, I just took an odd size bolt and I milled this type of thread onto it and screwed that in there, and it's really tight in there, which is why I haven't taken it out to demonstrate. And then that fits into a collet quite nicely, and that combination is shorter even than this thing is. So if I stick that in here, that leaves more room than the other two, this much more room. And what I like about this chuck is it runs really easily, which makes it much faster to adjust than a keyless thing like this, which takes a lot of turns. There's the jaws coming out now. This is a really good quality chuck, and I paid quite a bit for it, but I'm not using it now. And so with even my drill chuck mounting straight into the ER20 collet, that's these collets here, I only ever use the ER20 collet holder in here, so I really don't use any tooling with a BT30 spindle on it, so I didn't really need a BT30 spindle holder. So in retrospect, I should have just bought a spindle block that has basically just an ER20 collet on the end of it, not the BT30, and that would have been a fair bit narrower, probably would have weighed about 5 kilograms less, and stick out that way a bit less. And that means I would have needed fewer of these screen door springs to counterbalance the weight of this head, which has got this heavy thing on it, plus the motor on the back. And the runout on this thing is actually not too bad for a drill press. It's about 0.15 millimeters or about 6 thou. And I love having this XY table on my drill press.
The lead screws on this thing are of very questionable precision, but I've since then just added a DRO to it, so it doesn't matter as much. And this table is just too much cast iron to be cranking up and down on a drill press table, so having a machine where the head has all the movement makes more sense. And on this machine, I change the position that the head comes to rest at by pulling this pin out and then winching the rope up and down a bit, which basically changes where the springs are, because these springs don't have enough elasticity to go all the way from the top or the bottom. But having to pull this pin out every time is kind of annoying, almost as annoying as having to crank a drill press table up and down. So I'm going to replace this pin with some kind of ratchet. I took a few extra milling passes to get this to the measurement that I actually wanted. Uh-oh. It turns out I misread my calipers by 1 millimeter. Whoops. At least now I know how big a shim I'm gonna need. But it is a very nicely cut hole. So the goal is that this part with the slot guides this thing here and that catches on the notches here. But this wheel is big enough to really get in the way, so I have to make that a lot smaller. I glued my 1 millimeter shims in here and made a plug to go in here so I can use the compass again. This will be the ratchet wheel and this will catch it and that needs to pivot back here somewhere. And to drill a hole for that, I need to take the head off here. I should have marked the notches locations off the machine last time too. Can't get that locking pin out anymore. So that makes raising the head a lot faster. Though down is still a two-hand operation. Now if I move the position of the head, then the position of this lever changes, which I can reset rather easily. And that isn't such a big problem, but if I had a mechanism like on a regular drill press, I wouldn't need to do that at all. And with this one, it's easy to remember which position to go to, so if I want to drill to this line, I can just feel, okay, I need to go to here, and I don't even need to look at that to be able to hit that position repeatedly. So if I'm drilling in the piece of wood, I hardly ever use a depth stop. But I don't get that sense with this handle because it's just out in space and doesn't change an angle so much. So I have a very simple sort of depth stop in here, just a block of wood that the carriage bangs against, and it's locked by clamping a C-clamp to it. Otherwise, it slides not too badly. And while I've never hit my head against this pulley here, I have banged my head against this thing a few times. So a conventional three-handle spinny thing for plunging would probably be better. Now on a real drill press, this is done with a rack and pinion on a quill, but I can't make one like that. To make a pinion that's small enough and sturdy enough, I went with a lantern gear, and this experiment seems to be working fairly well. So I'm cutting out a lantern gear on my CNC. Oh, rats, these are a little bit too big. That's better. And then CNCing the rack to go with it. Oh, look what happened here. A rotor bit wandered out. Oops. The problem is what I'm using here is a carbide end mill, and it's just a bit too long for my palm router. This one's more meant for short little bits like this. On a full-size router, it goes in much further. And on a proper spindle with an ER20 collet, it could go way in. And I wanted to shorten it, but it's solid carbide, so a grinder won't do it. The only thing that'll work is a diamond disc. So cutting that same part again, but with the Y-reference moved over a little bit, so it cuts in a little bit further.
So I was about to use this thing, and then I realized the angles on this thing aren't the same. When I sketched this on the plywood, it wasn't right, so this time I drew it up in CAD. And the only reason I was cutting the holes here on the CNC is because they need to be positioned accurately. But I'm tired of spending time with a CNC, and I just don't have the patience for it. So I got my hole positions worked out here with Excel, and I'm just going to use a DRO to place these. So I got my lantern gear spinning on a bolt and the rock to fit against it, and that just works so nice. Now the plan was for this rock to come about this far forward and then the lantern gear against it like so, but that is a problem because this thing is in the way. So maybe if I come in behind like this, and then it has to go up against here, but then this is going to hit this part here, which means the handles have to come out way out this way, which means I really don't need this Y on the lantern gear at all, because the handles have to be way further out. And having burnt way too much time with a CNC, I was out of time for the day, so I had the evening to think about how to solve this. I ended up making this piece just really short on the end with a washer in the end, so I have room for this part here. So I took my lathe down from the shelf to make some knobs to go on the end of my Y-shaped hem. So I finally got this thing put back together, and while I was working on it, I had to use a regular drill press from time to time, and I really missed using this one. And just like with a regular drill press, on this one now, it's deceptively easy to squeeze down 50 kilograms, 100 pounds, or more. And for some operations, you really need that.